Hi, this is Corey Franklin with Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently, who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. And tonight we're going to start out briefly with a man who had a big effect on our culture, Eugene Poliey. Eugene Poliey died recently at the age of 96, and to find out what he did, I'm going to give you a BBC One report.
Now, the man who revolutionized the way we watch television has died at the age of 96. Eugene Poliey invented the remote control, which transformed generations of TV viewers into couch potatoes. His device was called the Flashmatic, and it was first produced in 1955, as Andy Moore reports.
In the early days of television, there weren't many programs to choose from. But if you did want to change channel, you had to walk all the way across the living room to do it. The remote control changed forever the way we watch TV. The wonderfully named Flashmatic pointed a beam of light at the TV set. If you were unlucky, other sources of light could change the channel for you. Eugene Polley patented 18 other inventions, but it's the remote control he'll be remembered for.
Earlier versions were very primitive.
Today, from the inventor of the wind-up radio, came this tribute.
Absolutely essential. I mean, I'm a lucky boy. I've got a television downstairs, television upstairs. When I'm in the bed, I can just lie down, pull the sheets back and go clip, clip, clip. No, clip, clip, off, sleep.
The first remote control looked like a big green hairdryer, but it was the prototype for much smaller devices.
The original remote control was so big we couldn't lose it. Now we have a whole array of the pesky things, for television, for DVDs, for air conditioning, for our cars. They've changed the way we live our lives.
And in the modern world of multi-channel digital television, it created a whole new world where the couch potato is king.
Mr. Poliey got a $1,000 bonus from Zenith, that's all he got. And he didn't even get much credit because pretty soon they switched from his light-based remote control to a sound-based one, and eventually to the infrared one that we use today. But isn't that always the way it is? Reminds me, after this show, I gotta go look for my remote. Well, our main feature tonight is gonna be Robin Gibb of the Bee Gees. Robin Gibb, along with his older brother Barry and his fraternal twin Maurice, formed the Bee Gees. Robin died recently at the age of 62, which makes Barry the oldest, the only surviving Bee Gee. Maurice died about 9 years ago, and the younger brother Andy, who wasn't part of the group, died about 20 years ago. The Bee Gees sold more than 200 million records worldwide, and they were in large part responsible for the disco craze, along with Donna Summer, who we talked about. Bee Gees started out in Manchester. They were born in the Isle of Man, and they moved when they were young kids to Australia. They were called 10-pound poms. This was a term they used about people they paid to come from England to Australia for 10 pounds after World War II for jobs. The Bee Gees' father was a musician, and he managed the boys, and they were a sort of a singing group when they were young before their voices changed, a la the Osmonds or a la the Jacksons. Here are Barry, Maurice, and Robin in their first television appearance in the late 1950s when Robin and Maurice were still very young boys.
Here are some of the boys I'm looking for. The Lee Henderson told me earlier they were down here in the audience. The BG. Barry, the leader of the group, come here. Barry Gibb and your young brothers. Now, come on, who are you? Which is which? You're twins, eh?
I'm Robin.
Robin?
Maurice.
And Maurice. Now, you all sing together, eh?
That's right.
And your brother Barry plays. Now, come on up. Come on up here. That's right. Come on up through there. Put you right in the picture. Put you right in the room. You're going to stand up on the high level? That's the thing. Now, is it true that you write your own pieces, Barry?
It's true, Desmond.
And what are you going to play for us now you've come down from Brisbane?
Time is passing by.
All right, then. We'll hear you all together.
As Robin described them, they were a self-contained group for about 5 years.
We created our own little kind of universe, you know, where we just wrote and created things. So it was very hard. It wasn't that we kept people out, it's just that people couldn't get in.
So as they became teenagers on Australian television, they played American rock standards. And songs by a new group on the exploding English music scene.
Bye. bet you never even try again.
Her father realized that England was where the music was, so he sent a tape to Brian Epstein. Brian Epstein forwarded it to his friend Robert Stigwood, and Robert Stigwood brought the Bee Gees back to England, gave them a contract, and they started making hit music. Their first song was a response to an American song, San Francisco, by Scott McKenzie. They didn't know anything about the United States, but they figured they'd write a song about going to the other part of the United States, the eastern part, and it's called Massachusetts, with Robin as the lead singer.
I'm going back to Massachusetts. Something's telling me I must go home. And the lights all went down in Massachusetts.
Robin was also featured on a couple of their other hits, including the New York 1910 mining disaster.
There is something I would like you all to see. It's just a photograph of someone that I knew. Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones.
Gotta get a message to you.
The preacher taunted me and he smiled. Said, come and walk with me, come and walk one more mile. Now for once in your life you're alone. But you ain't got a dime, there's no time for the fool. I just gotta get a message to you.
And I started a joke.
I started a joke. It started the whole kind. But I didn't see that the joke was on me.
But in the early 70s, tension broke out in the group, and here's the biographer Andrew Von Hayes to talk about what happened.
It was mainly over who was singing the song, because Barry was getting quite a lot of lead parts, and Robin had some problems early on coping with this, and really not quite sure exactly what it was all about, but Robin had a bit of a problem with amphetamines.
Barry was known to be smoking cannabis. Robin was using amphetamines and Maurice was drinking a lot. And to the industry, they were known as Pilly Polty and Pissy.
They broke up for a while and then got back together and had a key meeting with one of their label mates.
They spoke with label mate Eric Clapton. He said, what you want to do is you want to go over to Miami. You need to go and stay at this place called 461 Ocean Boulevard and go and record at Criteria Studios. Perfect setup, he said. And this is where the groove of songs like Jive Talking, the first big hit from that album, came from, going over the Biscayne Bridge, like sort of with the which Barry then replicates on guitar. And then there's also the story of where Barry was asked to scream in tune, and that was the first kind of falsetto to appear on a Bee Gees record.
So they were back, but then they went to France and cut what turned out to be one of the biggest albums of all time. It sold 30 million copies, the soundtrack to Saturday Night Fever.
We were very cautious at the very beginning of it because we didn't know. It was a low-budget film for Paramount, and yes, we didn't know what it was. And we let them have all this music that we'd written in France. And so that was in March, and the film came out in December.
Find,
And it just, from the very beginning, without any hype, just word of mouth. It just Huge. Was absolutely massive. But the album, I mean, it was just absolutely incredible worldwide. It was just stunning. On the Billboard charts alone, was number one for half a year, 6 months number one.
Well, that was clearly the height of their performing career. But what most people don't know is that Robin Gibb, along with his brothers, were the leading songwriting team of Britain in the 20th century, next to Lennon and McCartney. While they were recording, they were also writing songs, and here are some of the songs they wrote that you probably didn't know about. This huge song for Dolly Parton and Kenny Rogers.
All this love need be, needs no conversation.
This for a huge movie that revived Frankie Valli's career. This one that helped revive Dionne Warwick's career. And two huge hits for Barbara Streisand, including this one. And this one for Babs.
I am a woman in love, and I do anything to get you into my world and hold you within. It's a ride over and over again. What do I do?
It's a pretty decent musical catalog right there. I think it's safe to say Robin Gibb was a multifaceted musical genius.
If we had the choice between being in a nightclub and being in the studio, it'd be in the studio. But I never understood anybody who didn't have the desire to create.
The last thing he sang from his own composition, Requiem for the Titanic, last year.
Don't cry. Allow.
Well, to close the show tonight, we're going to talk about Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau. Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau was an opera star, and I'll be candid with you, I don't know much about opera, so I'm going to leave it to some people who do. We'll start with Matthew Bannister of the BBC for Last Word.
The death has been announced this afternoon of Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau, one of the most influential singers of the 20th century. The German baritone was best known for his interpretations of romantic Lieder, and particularly for his performances of Schubert's Winterreise. Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau was born in Berlin in 1925. He served in the German army during the Second World War and spent 2 years as a prisoner of the Americans. His professional career began in 1947, and he went on to appear in concert halls and opera houses all over the world.
Now I'll turn to another opera expert, Terry Teachout, who's a culture critic for the Wall Street Journal and happens to be well-versed, and here's what he wrote in his blog about Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau. Like all artists of distinction, Fischer-Dieskau deserves to be judged in the end by his best work, not his worst. Yet even at his best, he was an unusual artist, and thus by definition not to everyone's liking. It is easy to see, for instance, what the critic Greg Sandow had in mind when he complained that, "I wish he'd just let the music speak for itself." Instead, Fischer-Dieskau spoke for it, always perceptively and often beautifully, and at times distractingly. In addition, he was, like Frank Sinatra, a supremely confessional artist, and those who found this quality unsympathetic typically responded to his emotionalism with a combination of distaste and something not unlike embarrassment. What then are we to make of Fischer-Dieskau today? My own experience is worth recounting in this connection. Like so many music lovers of my generation, it was through his recordings that I discovered the beauty of German Lieder, and for a long time I thought there was no other way to sing them. Not until later did I become acquainted with the works of such singers of the 78 era as Tauber, Karl Erb, Hans Hatter, Gertrud Husch, Herbert Janssen, Alexander Kipnis, Larry Lehman, John McCormick, Charles Panzera, Heinrich Schuschlis, Askel Schlatz, and Elizabeth Schumann, all of whom exemplified in their differing ways the older tradition so eloquently epitomized by Samuel Lipman. The best of the older performances give an impression of simplicity combined with grandeur, of sensitivity to each poem's mood combined with clear, unforced, and unrestrained projection of the individual words. Even in Fischer-Dieskau's day, there were singers, most notably the mezzo-soprano Janet Baker and the tenor Peter Schreier, who offered alternatives to his interventionist style. In our own time, the mezzo-soprano Anna von Sophie von Otter and the baritone Bryn Terfel, none of whom, it happens, is German, have opted for a more plain-spoken interpretive path that I now find highly sympathetic. Yet I also find myself returning again and again to Fischer-Dieskau, perhaps not with the innocent pleasure of youth, but with what I hope is an enhanced appreciation of his special virtues. What I did not realize in the 70s, and what many critics then and now have failed to see, was that his style was not a solution to the problem of Lieder interpretation. It was, rather, the deeply personal, deeply considered approach of a remarkable artist, not to be imitated or held up as a universal standard, but simply to be savored for its own sake. Sometimes it worked, sometimes not, and at all times there were and continue to be other interpretive approaches that are equally valid. Musical interpretation, after all, is not an exact science. As I have written, the ambiguity of musical notation ensures that the classics cannot be played rightly or wrongly, only more or less interestingly. Yet surely there has never been a more interesting singer than Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau, nor on his best days, a greater one. Well, like I say, he's the expert. Here's a little bit of Dietrich Fischer-Dieskau singing Der Erlkönig by Schubert. This is where all that bad guy music comes from. Opera I saw had the Marx Brothers in it. I want to thank my producer, Sid Tepps, and we're going to close with a little opera. We're going to close with my favorite opera star, Elmer Fudd, singing a little bit of Wagner.
Stock. Might I inquire to ask if what's up, Doc?
I'm going to kill the rabbit.
Almighty hunk, that will be quite a test. How will you do it? Might I inquire to ask?
I will do it with my spear and magic helmet.
Your spear and magic helmet?
Spear and magic helmet.
Magic helmet.
Magic helmet.
Magic helmet.
Yeah.